written by Miles Davis, he calls So What? Thank you.
The whole concept of the European Universities Alliances is indeed something that we have never worked on. We never had the opportunity to reach a target, which is indeed to create what could be the universities of the future.
European universities are coming with a great promise to create student-centered education for the 21st century. Guten Morgen, Europa. Good morning, Europe. Welcome from Edinburgh to Krakow, from Coimbra to Turku. Welcome to the fourth panel debate on European higher education policy. My name is Tino Brömme. I'm the host of this conversation about this new phenomenon in higher education policy, which is European University Alliances. New networks of universities across borders in Europe who work together and with their surrounding ecosystem to create a better world. Today we are going to speak about European degrees, about degree design, a making of degrees. We will hear about competence frameworks and quality standards. We are supposed to make diplomas go across borders, to make them available, understandable across borders. We will discuss what mindset students need in the 21st century and what they might need for that. And we will discuss the underlying processes and policies from university level to national level to the international level. Thanks to the audience that already attended so numerously in the last panel, even now I see we have many participants from all over, and if you have a question, you can leave it in the comment section. We will pass them to the panelists as soon as possible. This is the fourth of a series of conversations on higher education policy and on university cooperation in Europe. This takes place with university members and with experts once a month, except in the summer. And for those of you who have to leave earlier, don't worry, we will put the recording of this stream on our website and also on YouTube, and on our website www.universitiesunited.eu. So, but now let's welcome our guests today. We are joined by Antonella Forlino, professor of biochemistry in Pavia. She is pro-rector of internationalization or international relations in Pavia, and also coordinates the European University Alliance EC2U from Pavia. She coordinates a central interconnectivity platform for this alliance, and she leads the task force for the creation of three new EC2U joint master degrees. And that's what we want to talk about in a moment. Our second participant in the first half of our debate is Professor Maria Gravari-Barbas. She has also been vice president for international relations at the Pantheon Sorbonne University in Paris. She is also chair of the cultural heritage focus area of UUU Europa, another European university alliance. And they create a new PhD, joint PhD program. Maria's background is in geography, and her research interests include tourism at World Heritage Sites, industrial and 20th century heritage, waterfront redevelopment, urban planning, and tourism. So we have someone who understands something about cities. So let's start with our discussion. Antonella, let's start a little bit. What is EC2U? So we want to understand, how do people work together in an alliance, and how does it come that you got the task of creating, of leading the task force about the joint degree?
Thank you for inviting me to this event. Well, EC2U is an acronym, the same for European Campus of City Universities. So our goal is really to create a university campus across Europe. We have 7 university partners in the Alliance, and among the other activity, what is central for our Alliance is to create joint master degree, 3 joint master degree courses, focused on 3 different sustainable developmental goals, and surrounding that with 3 virtual institutes. So will be is an alliance based on education and research. And the 3 master, that joint master that we wanted to activate are, as I mentioned, focused on 3 different sustainable developmental goals. One is good health and well-being, one is quality education, and the 3rd one, sustainable city and communities. And the reason why we actually needed to generate a task force is because in within creating these 3 different joint master with 3 different approach, and I will be happy to get a bit more on that if I have time, we really face some critic issue related to accreditation on of this joint master. And that's the reason why, even if each master has its own leaders, and all master have the participation of member of each university, then there are some common issues faced by all 3 of them that really require, in our view, to generate a task force to face this kind of critical issues.
You said the task force is quite new, and they headache. Why? What do you mean?
Well, the fact is that when you create a giant master, of course, first of all, at the beginning of the project, even before the application, we thought about the content of the master, and then we were excited in proposing new way to create joint master. So we imagine to have 3 different models, and then we come to reality, meaning that we were granted by the EU, very excited to start, and then it comes to, okay, let's accreditate the master. And this is the first step that make us realize a task force was needed, because each national accreditation system is different. And still up to now, the European approach is not accepted, at least for the universities, for the nation of our alliance. So we need to have a single accreditation for each single country. And of course, these put a lot of constraints, because all the different systems are different. All different systems have their own specificity, their own requirement. And believe me, to put together the requirement from 7 different nations is not a tricky issue to face. So that's the reason of the task force, and that's the reason I have been asked to actually coordinate this task force. That I have to tell, I'm coordinating, but the most part of the work are really performed by the work package leader, so the coordinator of the master. And we faced also the necessity to involve the administrative person involved in each university, because they are really the one knowing the specific administrative step, because it's more the main critique are these administrative steps to face.
You have been creating courses before the University Alliance was created, it was formed. So what's the difference between, you said they have different countries with their own accreditation system. Are there other differences? Is there something, what are the other news and the new difficulties you're facing?
Well, the main stuff is that when you create a course in your university, your own university, you do have some specific requirement, national requirement, and some also internal requirement that you can, they are not easy to handle, but you can address because you are part of the system. even when you try, and we did that this year, actually the past year, to try to create inter-academic but national course, you have to face some differences due to the difference of the universities, let's say Italian one. But really, when you have to move to a different country, the main issue is not so much in the content in terms of topics, because you know which kind of student you want to prepare. You have a common path, a common educational path that you foresee the society needs, and you want to prepare the student for that. So not so much on the content, but on organization of the content. For example, just to be concrete as much as possible, the number of exams are different in the different country. The number of language that people need to know and the level is different in the different country. And then in some country, you need to have some specific educational sector that you have to cover in order to provide a specific degree, but they are different in the different countries. So all this issue, if we are not, I mean, as long as we will not be able to really adopt an European approach, this will be an issue. And the other things that I want to mention is the quality assurance, because each university has to have their own quality assurance. We foresee, and we actually have in within the Alliance a quality council, but that's not enough for some of the university partner to handle the quality of the master. So on top of our quality council, we need to build up a quality assurance bodies for the master. And that's another issue that with a European approach, we will probably be able to bypass, but at the moment is still a problem. Although all phase is really involved in interacting with the national bodies, but of course, I don't foresee this as a quick process to be actually bypassed.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's do a little bit of to and fro between you and Maria, so we have a little bit more dynamics here. Maria, good hello again. Before we introduce UUU Europa and your particular PhD, what were you thinking when Antonella was speaking? Yes, I have the same problem.
Well, obviously, we do have the same problems, and I think that this is more or less the case for all European alliances. In fact, we are really pioneers. I mean, we are starting thinking, and we have projects for which the framework does not exist yet. So we are not only inventing the contents, which is, I mean, our degrees, we also need to invent the framework that goes with these projects and that will allow to these projects to exist. So I totally understand what you said, Antonella. We also are facing the same issues, and we are trying to find solutions which in fact are more engineering solutions at this moment, expecting that we will be able to have the European degree. The problem is that this European degree does not exist yet. If we take the scenario of eventually a quality label available for any joint program, as the ones you mentioned, Antonella, or the programs that we are initiating in UUU Europa, the question is that in order to award this label, we need to have a designated body, which does not exist for the moment. If we take another scenario, which is that the European degree becomes a qualification in its own right, the question is who can, in fact, award this European degree on what legal basis? So those are totally open, totally pending questions that we will have to solve, I think, collectively, because I'm sure that all alliances are facing the same problems, independently of the level of the programs, be they bachelors, masters, or PhDs. We do have the same issues.
Now I'm curious about your joint program, which is a PhD. Let's wrap it up from behind. This called cultural heritage PhD, right? And how did this come about? What's the beginning? How does the idea and the content and then the composition start to develop? Can you describe the process so that the outsiders see how such a thing is working?
Yeah, well, in fact, from the beginning of our alliance, we started working on design, specifically, in fact, defined thematic areas, focus areas. So cultural heritage is one of these focus areas, along with European studies, sustainability, one health, and digital sciences. So from the beginning, we knew that our programs, at least to start with, would be within these focus areas. And in fact, as we are pilots and as we needed to try all possible, in fact, levels of higher education, we defined that, for example, in this focus area, we will start with the bachelor. In this other focus area, we will start with micromasters. And in this focus area, specifically cultural heritage, we will work on a joint PhD. So yeah, this is one of our pilots, and our approach was in fact to start building what we name self-steering committees for each of those thematic areas, which in fact bring together the European communities of our 8 universities working on this transdisciplinary research and pedagogical areas. So this is how, in fact, we proceeded also for cultural heritage. The idea was to create this European community of our 8 universities in a totally transdisciplinary basis, bringing together all possible disciplines and colleagues working on the different aspects of cultural heritage. So we are working with this approach, and the joint PhD is one of our GIFs, joint innovative formats. And as I said before, the other formats can be a bachelor, a joint bachelor, they can be micromasters, they can be workshops and many other activities.
Some people marry to then solve problems that I didn't have before. Do you think that these courses, these alliance made, these alliance cooperation courses make the universities better?
Well, yes. I mean, it's extremely challenging, and clearly there is an added value. I think that if we are doing all those efforts, and I mean, we are really trying hard in order to make this European alliances exist, this is because we truly believe that there is a huge added European value. Of course, the idea is not to make better our universities. Our universities, they have their personality, their identity. The idea is to create something new out of our universities or with our universities. So yeah, I think that most of us, we are totally sure that this will bring a huge added value for our students, first of all, but also for our academic communities.
Maria, please stay for another moment. But Antonella, I want to ask you the same question. I mean, sometimes these people, these artists who make children's books, there are wonderful people and they make something wonderful for themselves while creating this children book, but sometimes I don't like these children books. So not necessarily what the makers think about themselves is then in the result as beautiful. Why do you think these international cooperation, which is a kind of new and more complex than before, why do you think it's a benefit for the university or for the courses that you create?
Well, I don't know, as I agree with what Maria said, it's not a matter to ameliorate our own university, but it's just a different vision of higher education, which I do believe is needed now, because we don't have anymore the feeling that education needs to be restricted in a city or in a country. We are living in an open world, and to have a university, a European university, European campus, will really help to build up the future citizen. They will not be Italian, France, or Greek. They will be European. And if we have this vision, then I do believe that we can create, from the education point of view, what I believe in, and I think it will be the Europe of the future. Everything starts from education, but education needs to change its national vision. So it's not a matter to improve the University of Pavia or the University of Poitiers or the University of Turku. It's a matter of create a new university for the new student of the future. And the future starts now. I don't believe that the future is some time that will come after my time. I do believe that the future is now, it started. And this is a great opportunity, very demanding. I agree with Maria, is extremely difficult sometimes. You really need to believe on that. But we do that for us and for the student. And overall, I do believe for Europe and world as well.
Maria, for you, a last question before you have to leave. Exactly, yeah. You have a little hurry because you have a workshop on that very PhD we're talking about. Can you tell us what you're doing there and what you will do when you leave us here?
A very, very exciting adventure, because in fact we launched a PhD workshop which was supposed to take place in Paris in October 2020, but due to the pandemic situation, we postponed it to May. At that time, we hoped that we would be able to host the students in Paris. Of course, you know how it happens, and finally the workshop takes place online. But what is wonderful, I think, and this was a kind of extremely interesting experience, is that our PhD students, we have 40 PhD students from all our universities working on cultural heritage, but coming from totally different disciplines. We can have social sciences, we can have chemists, we can have, all UNO Europa disciplines are represented. So this PhD students worked together during the last 10 months, since the moment they were selected till now that they are presenting their works. They've been working together online, and this is, of course, the positive aspect of the virtualization that we had, in fact, to which we had to adapt. We created the first cohort of UNO Europa, the first cohort of PhD students working on cultural heritage. They know each other, they work together, they discover totally different disciplinary approaches, methodological approaches, and they are presenting today their works in a kind of totally transversal approach, which is, I think, an excellent output of this added, an excellent example of this added value we spoke before, because clearly we do have, all of us, excellent students in Parian, in Freie University, in KU Leuven, or in Bologna. But bring them together, create something new, which is transnational, is interdisciplinary, is multilingual. And this European approach, I think, is something really fantastic.
I think we need some flight airplane company to sponsor the flights for these students when they want to meet. we are coming to the first half of our encounter here. Thank you, Maria Gravari-Barbas and Antonella Forlino. Before we get to the next part, it's also about UNO Europa students who we interviewed at the last convention. And we will look, after we heard them now, the recording of their opinion, we will look into the policies and the processes on national and European level. So thank you for now, and let's have a look at what the students actually say.
I would love to see universities cooperating between one another.
I imagine something more innovative that Europa could bring.
My dream is to study and travel. This idea of university coming from a past and not changing, it's just a block and they still do the same things. No, this is not the idea they have.
Different ways of creating and sharing knowledge are better than only one way.
The future university for me is like international, not just like inter-European university, but like a huge one, like, you know. Like I would see like universities from Mexico, from Australia, from China together.
More integrated and holistic view of university.
The university of the future would be the European universities of national level, bringing together their competences and their skills to create a better environment of learning that can be a matter of attraction for both European students as well as the foreign students.
Like having a course as a podcast that you can just listen to on the way.
More on time with what we are experiencing in the world right now.
If I want to study one semester here, that's okay. If I want to study one semester in France, I do it there.
I believe it's essential. I mean, what we see in the world is the US, China, these giants, and we have to do something together if you want to compete.
Well, hello again. These were the students of UUU Europa saying what they imagine is their ideal university of the future. After we've heard Antonella Forlino and Maria Gravari-Barbas telling their routine in making new degrees, we want to go a step further now and look at the European policies and the ideas of education that flow into them. Our next two panelists are Robert Wagenaar and François Tadei. Robert Wagenaar is professor of history and politics of higher education, former dean of the Faculty of Arts at the University of Groningen. He is president of the Erasmus Mundus joint master degree Euroculture, Society, Politics and Culture in a Global Context, which is running since many years. As an external expert for the European Commission, he was involved in preparing the Bologna process, ECTS and equality frameworks. He's also the co-author of last year's Rethinking an Educational Model Suitable for 21st Century Need. Our second participant in this second part of the panel is François Tadei. He is a biologist of origin and an innovator of education. He co-founded the Center of for Research and Interdisciplinarity, CRI, in Paris. He has conducted successful experiments, pedagogical experiments with school children. He created bachelor, master's, and PhD programs, helping students to develop their own research projects. He also participated in various working groups concerned with French and European higher education policy. Now, let's go on. I'd like to start with François, if possible. Hello. Ah, hello. I see you. I am so glad. Hello. Thank you that you made it. How are you?
I'm fine.
All right. Last year you wrote the book Learning in the 21st Century. We have just been hearing Antonella and Maria talking about how they create these joint master degrees and these joint PhD degrees. You haven't been joining just now, but you know certainly similar examples. When you look at the European University Alliances, which of your proposals of a good learning you see realized or you feel understood?
Oh, I think many things are happening within the new university alliances at the European level. I think that, you know, challenge-based is becoming a key driver for many programs. I think it's much more close to the students' perspective, and, you know, more and more programs are co-designed with the students' interest taken into account. And, you know, their motivations and their, you know, fear and hopes with the climate change or the COVID and so on and so forth. I think, you know, this is an important change, I think, that is happening. And clearly, you know, it's much more interdisciplinary, because if you want to go for the challenges, you have to have combinations of disciplines. So I think, you know, this is clearly happening. And the other thing that is obviously happening at an accelerated pace is the digitalization of many of these things. You know, first, because if you are throughout Europe, it's so much easier to have this. And second, of course, the COVID crisis has accelerated many digitalization of programs. And whether people were ready for it or not, you know, it made a difference, of course. But to a large extent, this is an accelerated process as well.
I remember we have been talking last year also during the beginning of the pandemic, even before I remember, we talked about the making of these European university alliances. You told me that somehow you were also involved in one of those original designs. Which alliance was that, and what was your input?
Actually, we worked in two ways for the European Alliance. We worked with the Commission, you know, while they were preparing the calls. And we also worked with the University of Paris Alliance that is called Circle U, and that involved, you know, people in Berlin, in Oslo, in Belgrade, in Aarhus, in Louvain-la-Neuve, and King's. I think that's the consortium. And so that's the sort of alliance that's indeed is an interesting opportunity, especially from the French perspective, because, you know, the French universities were transforming themselves with, you know, some national funds for excellence initiatives and new pedagogies. But, you know, this internationalization played an interesting role to accelerate some of the transformation. And you know, do the benchmark and convince ever more actors. Because it's one thing to innovate locally within the university; it's another to have an impact at the university level. And that's much easier when a university is seeing itself within a network of peers that are, you know, trying to move ahead. And so that ability of working with others makes this innovations much easier, because you know this old saying that nobody's a prophet in his own country, you know, and so if you see partners that are moving in the same direction, then you feel much more comfortable that, you know, this is an interesting direction. If you're going on your own, you know, it's always much more difficult to convince.
Your own institution, the Center for Research and Interdisciplinarity, this is kind of a research institute, right? So you are studying and promoting better education, better learning, if I understand well. You can correct me. What do you think can the European University Alliances learn from your results?
I think there are several dimensions. One is that, you know, learning through research, which is considered, you know, the best that the universities can offer, can be offered not only at the PhD level and the master level, but it can also work with, you know, undergrads, and actually it works with school children. Okay? So I think that that's a very important dimension. And so that you can start with the somewhat naive questioning of the young ones, and you can offer them methods, like the scientific method, not to give them answers, but to provide them with the toolbox and the attitudes and the ability to cooperate, the ability to benchmark, the ability to develop critical thinking, the ability to develop all these 21st century skills, and develop this very early on and build on this. And on the way, learn all the content that you need to be able to tackle, you know, this project or that project that the students have contributed to co-design. So I think that's a very generic principle that can be applied nearly everywhere, and not just in elite places, you know, especially for school children. We did it even in the poorest neighborhoods in France and progressively in other countries. And in fact, it works even better with students that are less privileged. And that's an interesting surprise. And then another dimension is among the research we do is we try to develop artificial intelligence and use it at the service of collective intelligence. So I can give you one quick example. We've developed an AI that has read all of Wikipedia and is doing what's called text-to-vec, so it transforms any text, like a Wikipedia page, into a vector. And then with these vectors, you can compute distances and therefore proximities. And so when you use this for students' project, for instance, that are text, you can say, oh, your student project is very close to a student project across the campus, across the city, or across Europe, or across the world. And then you can start connecting students of different disciplines, different countries, different universities, so that they can start cooperating at a scale that is somewhat unprecedented. You use these combinations of AI on one side and collective intelligence on the other side to do some sort of matchmaking, if you want. And in a way, you know, you can build this GPS of projects, and even if it's sort of a GPS of dreams, and be somewhat like John Lennon, you know. I may be a dreamer, but I don't want to be the only one. Because if I'm the only one, I may not be able to succeed. But if I manage to collaborate with others, then, you know, I might find a critical mass that turns, you know, the dream into a project and the project into a reality.
Well, GPS of dreams will go into my book of good new terms. I would have so many questions for Robert, but I would like him to answer just out of his stomach after what he just heard.
Thank you for inviting me, first of all, to participate. Yeah, I fully agree with what François has said. He gave a good overview of the policies that actually were the basis of what we are trying now to establish, because this doesn't come out of the blue. European universities has a long history in that respect, and it started already in the 1990s. There was tremendous concern about the quality and the relevance of higher education institutions. You referred to the 21st century skills. They didn't exist in the previous century as an issue, and they developed also as a result of the Bologna process, but also the work of tuning. They became to the surveys as important issues. The main issue from the very start was concern about the relevance of universities and teaching and learning for society, because you might remember that already at the end of the previous century, there was high unemployment, youth unemployment. And of course, this was repeated in 2008 as a result of the crisis. And it was very clear that there was a mismatch between what was needed in society and what was delivered by universities. So this European Universities Initiative should also be seen in the context of making these reforms for the better good of the learner, but also for the universities. Because we are now, in a knowledge-based society, we are competing with the rest of the world, and that was also one of the reasons to set up the Bologna process in the first place. And what we're trying to roll out now, strategically, with the European Universities Initiative, is actually the same, to a large extent, of the original aims of the Bologna process.
Mm-hmm.
And successful in that respect, because the reforms in particular in teaching and learning are taking place very slowly. We promoted, of course, the whole idea of changing the paradigm of learning from staff-centered to student-centered. But what we can see is that staff members have tremendous difficulties to get this new philosophy on board, because they have not been trained in that respect.
Mm-hmm. There is an impression that these European University Alliance are gaining more important at the European Commission. They are throwing a lot of money at them. They can also participate in Horizon Europe calls, and there was this EIT call. A third call for European University Alliances is being prepared. And do you think that this growing, this increasing funding and this growing influence of the European Commission into these, into this development of education policy, is a good thing?
Yeah, probably it's the only way, because there is no other money available anyway, and you need money to make change. I wouldn't overestimate the role of the European Commission, because this has been an agenda that has been set by countries in the Bologna process, and it got a new boost because of Macron's speech. But what they tried to establish is what actually was meant to establish over 20 years. And this is a different strategy that was used in the past. And I agree with François as well, that there is now giving more visibility to the role of universities, because that was indeed the problem with regard to the Bologna process as it has been rolled out during the last 20 years. Universities were more or less invisible. And now, because of this European Universities Association initiative, they become more visible, they become a major player. So you can, from the perspective of the European Commission, you can see this as a new strategic means to make the change they were working on for now at least 25 years.
There's something comes to my mind, and I want to come back to François for a second. François, you already mentioned the participation of the students, and I would like you to share a little bit more. How can students best be involved, and how? Because I see some of the alliances have it as headlines, some have it as a secondary alliance, saying students can participate in creating curricula, can be involved in making their own way, because people consider them also aware of what's important around them. But maybe you can say a little bit, how can, because I hear they have difficulties, they don't know how, they don't have the fantasy sometimes to get away from an old student model. What are your proposals, or what do you know what is a good approach?
I think that co-designing with students can make a real difference. If you ask university professors to innovate, they will, you know, innovate somewhere. But if you invite the students to co-design with the university professor, then suddenly you open up the possibilities. And if you manage to find a resource to take the students' perspective seriously, you know, we've done it, and I'm pretty sure, you know, lots of people are doing it, but being able to co-design the building, co-design the curriculum, co-design, you know, the interactions, co-design the evaluation process, co-design, you know, the interaction with society, co-design new research projects, even new citizen science projects where, you know, the students can be the living link between, you know, the ivory tower of academia and disciplinary boundaries and the interest of the citizens and the civil society. And so you can create a space where, which has been well defined by some sociologists of innovation as a middle ground. Okay, so let's say the upper ground is the institution. Okay, the on the ground are, you know, the civil society or the students' engagement. You know, students have all sorts of NGO that they build and so on. But if you build a middle ground, you can have the best of the students' engagement and the interaction with society connected to academia and, you know, all sorts of research methods and tools that can make this much more efficient. And this middle ground, so the upper ground is the institution and the university, but it could be the city, it could be the UNESCO, it could be, you know, all sorts of stakeholders in companies and so on. And the students, and so you have to create a space where the students' voice is considered legitimate to co-construct. And you have to develop methods for this. You have to start convincing the university leadership and, you know, all sorts of people that are in institutions and are not necessarily used to co-design methods, that this is a legitimate method and it's going to provide, you know, results that, you know, can be evaluated. Students can start winning awards in variety of places, national and international, and they start getting recognition. And so you can build this frame of freedom that will be evolving progressively. You know, we started with a few square meters and a handful of students, and we've grown exponentially, doubling in size every 18 months with these sorts of processes. And so I think this co-design works. At least it worked in France, and I've seen it happen in a variety of countries progressively. And I think that, you know, this is progressively impacting the bulk of academia, but it's a slow process.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm wondering, Robert, you have been following the Bologna process constructively, participating in constructing it and thinking it, and now you are also observing the progresses that are made through the European University Alliances. The participation of students, how far can it go? Because, I mean, historically seen, the say that students have in academic senates and in the university has decreased over the decades.
And I don't see where in a university gremium a student is more than one student against 40 professors. So is this approach that the university alliances have to make students participate in the curricular design, is it sufficient, or should there be more democracy in universities? How do you see this relation?
I'm not sure it's about democracy, and I agree with François that students should play an important role. And of course, in the Netherlands, we have a little bit different tradition than in most other countries. Students have been involved for a long time in curriculum design, have been members of committees with regard to the redesigning of programs. And that has been very rewarding, because what we found out also in the research we did is that students have a very good view about the future and about their possibilities with regard to that future. So as an input for programs, besides of course the input of other stakeholders, and this can be society at large, as also François said, this has proven to be very important. You get better programs, but most of all, you get ownership. So ownership there should be with regard to the staff responsible, but also with regard to the students. And just to give you an example, we have set up a course, Learning History, which makes a relation to society and involves students very much in their role in terms of the program. So they put a lot of input and their own thinking with regard to the program. This is very stimulating, very helpful, and also very useful for themselves, but also for society. So the strategies which have been also outlined by François, they actually work. But we also found out that we have a long way to go. Because in most countries, in most programs, this is still a novelty. So this change still has to be made. Student-centered learning is not yet a given. So active learning is not by definition a given, although we are doing slightly better in Europe at the moment, also as a result of this process, than in other countries. But I really think that the European Universities Initiative can give a boost to this, because it forces you on a voluntary basis to cooperate with each other and to learn from each other in an international context. And it's true, you need others to make change. You need outsiders to make change. This is a long tradition, which you can see over time. And this is also the case for European universities.
There was this beautiful occupation of the University of Amsterdam a few years ago. It was 6 weeks long. I was very impressed. They invited what's his name, the one from We Are the 99%, who wrote the book Dead, the First 5,000 Years. His name is avoiding me now. However, they made a lot of interesting panel discussions, public discussions in English, so it was you could follow it all over Europe, all over the world actually. And they made created two new committees in the universities where the students actually got more to say. They could look into the financial structure of universities, which was a financial committee, and then there was a second committee, a democratization committee, I remember something like that, where and this is a few years ago now. I don't know what is left of this, but I must say this was an approach where student participation was very strong. And on the other hand, you have some countries which have not even their elected student representatives have a big say. So maybe these European university alliances are a big advantage for, I would say, a country, I don't know, Poland or Cyprus, but maybe the participation level is now leveled out on a middle level, I don't know. What do you think will be the most positive effects on a European level through these university alliances, Robert?
Yeah, if we can really get involvement of students and also staff in making better programs, that would be a tremendous step forward. And it doesn't depend on democratization as such in terms of its structures. What is very important is that students get involved in curriculum design, also checking whether the curricula actually deliver what they promise, improve them over time. And this is done at the level of a department. And this doesn't require the whole structure of involvement of students with regard to finances, etc., although it plays a role by definition. But if you can develop indeed ownership, as I said before, with regard to the program that is followed, it is very helpful. So in my joint international master, our students play a role, a very important role, because it's their product. It's also the product of the staff, but it's also their product. Mm-hmm. And what we can see also, that is the international dimension, that when you bring together students from different settings, it's a much more inspirational setting than a purely national setting. And that is also very helpful. And of course, the European Universities Initiative will be of help here. So it probably will make better universities, it will make more inspirational universities. Is this a political issue? Yeah, it's a political issue. At the same time, it's also in the advantage, I think, of the universities as such, the individual universities.
Mm-hmm. François, when there's more money coming from the European Commission, I mean, now already the universities struggle for autonomy in regard to their ministries and their ideas what students shall be produced for the labor market. Now the European Commission also wants a word in it. How do you see, do you think that this new development with the European University Alliances, where the European Commission is more involved than before, that this will change the European higher education landscape, and this will maybe be also not only positive for the universities?
I mean, you know, there's a long history of, you know, politics versus autonomy in university and the place of funding, you know, since the very beginning of European universities centuries ago. So this is always a debate. But, you know, the percentage of the money within the university alliance compared to the budget of university is relatively small. So I'm not so worried for this. But I do see interesting leverage effect because, I mean, the innovators, those that were pro-innovations within university, suddenly get much more voice and much more support because they are all aligning and they can look at the best practice of their colleagues within alliance and between alliances. And so I think, you know, this is quite positive. But I also think that the students are very concerned with, you know, all sort of sustainability issues, you know, climate change and COVID crisis and so on. And so they are concerned with societal issues. Okay. And EU is also concerned with societal issues. And therefore there can be a sort of an alliance between the students and the funder for a change that goes, you know, towards more student-centered projects for society. Okay. And so this sort of alliance might not have happened in many nations. Okay, I mean, countries like Netherlands or Scandinavia were doing these sorts of things before, but many countries were not involving their students in these sorts of project as much. Plus, you know, I think that we can all share experience and we can all learn from one another and we can progressively build what I tend to call learning universities. Okay, universities are learning in the way they do research constantly. They don't learn so much on the way their students are learning, what are their students' interests. And I think that, you know, the students as a human being, a complex human being, not just, you know, someone there to pass exam, is a concept that, you know, should have been there always, but sometimes it's been forgotten. Because, you know, we tend to focus on, you know, the big numbers of students, and so we have to have process, and then we tend to forget about all sorts of needs. You know, the Maslow pyramid of needs is not systematically taken into consideration by all universities across Europe. And I think that, you know, inviting students in the conversation in a much more systematic way is a way to help them find purpose. Because at the moment, the level of despair of students where their present is destroyed by the COVID pandemic and their future is endangered by the climate crisis, it's very hard to be a young person and be optimistic about, you know, the present and the future. And so I think giving them more agency and inviting them in what we call Transform U, which is a movement to transform universities, is an interesting moment. And I think it's not true only of students. You know, citizens across countries are more and more involved in the climate change. You know, in France, we had this Convention Citoyenne for the Climate. Okay, and of course, there is a big discussion on, you know, do you listen to the point of view of the citizen or of the students when you decide at the higher level of policies? But at least that there is a dialogue is a good starting point, because it can only benefit everyone to be in this co-constructing mode.
Thank you. Antonella, what do you think? Has a dialogue been started with the students across through the university alliances you're working with? Has it already a positive effect?
Yeah, we do have in our organization the presence of students basically at each level of governance of the new European campus university. So yeah, they are present, they are involved, and in one of the curricula in particular, they will be able, coming back to student-centered education, they will be able to really choose the best educational path based on their interest. So they definitely they are present, and they will be actually the protagonist of their own specific curriculum in that specific curriculum that we are developing. And I do agree with what it was said. The change in teacher versus student center education is an important step that has been already took place in some country, not in all the countries. In Italy, the students are getting more and more in within, not so much yet the development of the curricula, but definitely they give us their feedback on what they really need and what they really would like to learn. And a good way, I believe, that can be kind of a way to go to arrive there and make them really the center of their own education is the adoption of the micro-credential. That is another topic that our alliance is very into it. And as university, we already are facing and try to developing, because that will be a step allowing the student to really build up their own education based on what the society is requesting, what they are there interesting, and really be the protagonist of their formation.
Oh, thank you. Robert, this is a nice keyword for you. Maybe not everybody knows what micro-credentials are. Could you explain and then say what might be the advantages of them?
Yeah, it's actually an American term, and it has become very hot, and I'm not sure why it is so hot, to be honest. But what it offers, of course, is flexibility, and it tries to align in particular to the needs of society. What universities should do is actually take this into account and make their own programs more flexible by using this term micro-credentials, which actually, of course, is a small course unit which tries to match a particular needs in society with the learning that will take place anyway. So it's a flexible means, but of course, it's nothing new in that respect, although it's so hot. It has been set up in the United States as an alternative to European university learning. What we should do, of course, in Europe is integrating this in a lifelong learning context, because we have to realize that we are now talking about a 40 years curriculum. People will be in the workforce for at least 40 years, and they have to keep developing. If we look back 20 years without the computers, or 25 years, 30 years without the computer setting we have today, it was a different world. In 20 years, it will also be a different world. So you have to keep on learning. And European universities in general, or universities in general, should of course take a responsibility for this, and their micro-credentials play a role. So you also create a new audience with regard to credits that have to come back to the university to be graded in terms of their learning, both in knowledge and in skills, and also probably responsibilities and autonomy, but probably together with the new generations. What is very interesting, I think, in general, with regard to the initiative of European universities, it has created new momentum. And that is interesting because it can take into account things like climate change, but also the discussion about flexible learning and lifelong learning. It has been in the market for at least two decades, but now it has been taken up by European university authorities. And I hope also it will be taken up by staff, academic staff and students.
But wait a moment, François, I think you must have reacted somehow now, because once you said to me, well, the students are already looking elsewhere for their education. So I don't know if I'm wrong, but these micro-credentials are a reaction to the fact that you can get your education elsewhere, that you can get short courses, short qualifications elsewhere, and the universities are reacting now. Or how is this relation actually?
I think there is a lot that is happening exactly as Robert is saying. You know, the accelerations of the changes of the world make people needy to keep learning so many things. Okay? And some of it will be available within universities, or some of it will be available, you know, on the web, or you know, at work, or in a variety of places. And I think, you know, there is a few interesting initiatives. For instance, in Singapore, they decided to put money to encourage this lifelong learning systematically. And like University of Singapore, for instance, has decided that their students are students for 20 years. Why not lifelong? I don't know, but you know, 20 years is more than the usual bachelor program or master program. And so they basically want to invite those to come back again and again. Okay, so they are part of the community for you know, at least 20 years. In France, we've a couple of years back, the Minister of Labor has launched the compte personnel de formation, so a personal training account, where every French citizen that is working is having, you know, 500 to 1,000 euro a year to invest in their own training. Okay, so it used to be that the company was paying for you, and then the company was deciding what you should be learning. Now it's a personal account, and there is like an open market where you can pay for, you know, the training that you think is the most appropriate to your personal needs, regardless of what your company might say. And so there is a double budget. You may want to double that budget with the help of the company, but you may decide that you want to do something very different because you're thinking of your next job maybe, or you just want to have personal development or for all sorts of reasons. And so this is a big change. And I think this is not only creating a market, this is creating an incentive to have a lifelong learning portfolio where, you know, what you've been learning in school, in university, and through this type of account, or what you're learning, you know, independently. And so they could be the same way we have health records that are lifelong. Why don't we have learning records that are lifelong? And then we can have, you know, AI analyzing this type of data and starting to make recommendations. Because with this sort of GPS that can help you to know what you know, but also what you don't know, and to learn what it is that you should know if you want to change job, or what it is that's, you know, you may want to know if you want to look for a change in your personal experience. And so disabilities is opening a huge numbers of possibilities. And I think that we need an R&D of this learning. Because, I mean, universities do some research on the learning happening within, not as much as they do on many other topics, or not as much as they should, but research on lifelong learning in the digital age can be, I believe is at the very beginning of this. So, you know, how can we help learners to identify the quickest learning paths to go from what they already know to what they should know in order to face, you know, the challenges that they want to face is an open question. And how can a mixture of, you know, privacy issues, technological issues, societal issues can be taken into account in new sets of research program? And how can we develop, you know, a European vision of this versus, you know, the American way or the Chinese way, which are using, you know, this big data in very different perspectives?
Robert,
here we have a constellation of lifelong learning and a very flexible and intelligent approach, and the necessities of these university alliances who have some freedom with their budget, but who have to face accreditation, quality assurance, coordination among the institutions. So do you think that this European University Alliances program offers enough, let's say, flexibility, freedom to overcome the necessities in order to go into this very interesting direction that Francois is indicating?
Well, I think you have no choice. That also means that in political terms, there is no choice, because this will be the future. And flexible pathways are the future anyway, and individualized learning is very important. So if universities want to keep a role, they have to invest in this in one way or another. Indeed, we have to deal with more or less rigid structures. And of course the national governments, but also the European Commission, but in particular national governments come into play. They should allow this flexibility. And there we see differences between countries. And this is also a tradition. It has to do with the Napoleonic, the Anglo-Saxon tradition, Humboldtian tradition, the old Soviet model. Some systems are more rigid than others. We can't afford having these rigid systems anymore. So in that sense, in those countries where there are still relatively rigid systems, governments have to give in. They have to give more flexibility to universities. And maybe these alliances might help to win this flexibility, because it will be a powerful force to make change, and it's also in the interest of governments and countries for the sake of the learning, for the learner, but also for society at large. So in that respect, I'm optimistic, and I think this new initiative will help in putting pressure on the political dimension of higher education.
Robert, I want to ask afterwards also the others the same question at the end. I had it just on the tip of my tongue. the university alliances, do you think that they are like an exception, that they are something they have particularly chances now that the rest of society doesn't really participate in, or not necessarily, or do you think that they are a symptom of a change in society that that is now going on?
Cooperate anyway. In particular in the European setting, we are in competition with the United States, with China, so we have to pool resources in an effective way. Internationalization won't go away, globalization won't go away. And in that respect, of course, this is symbolic with regard to development in societies. The fact that you can organize it in a structured way with six to, let's say, nine partners is probably a good way forward, although it will be a tremendous challenge. We are talking indeed about small money. So the incentive has to come from inside as well. So people really have to believe in these developments. But indeed, the problems are large, like climate change, but also information, the information society. So in that respect, I think, it's a symbol of the time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'd ask the same question to Antonella. Do you think that the universities, and especially the university alliances now, are indicating a change in society, or are they still a very rare and exotic exception?
Well, I think that they are needed. So considering the time that we are facing, to have a European university is really a demand. As Robert said, we face competition with other part of the world, and it is really, I know it is in its pilot phase, but that's what we really need to do. Will be definitely the issue of sustainability. There is a problem that we will have to face, because as mentioned, they don't come with a huge amount of resource able to make sure and allow us to think they will last forever. But strongly believing in this European university, I believe that single partners will find not only motivation but also money to support them. And of course, the Europe should believe in that and allow us to have not only a short-term vision but or mid-term vision but a long-term vision. But definitely, they are not like coming out from nowhere. Is something that has been built up as a need for the higher education in Europe. So no, I don't believe that it's something that come up from the blue.
Well, they are coming certainly from Italy, because this program is also co-designed by Italian students and graduates like Thomas Rigoni as our editor, and Enrico Masi, who is the director of the documentary that we are planning to do sooner or later. And so I'd like to ask the question again also to François. How let's say, indicative are these experiments in university alliances now, in your opinion, to lead the way?
I think that the world is changing so fast that, you know, we used to train our students to compete with one another on yesterday's knowledge. And today they have access to a lot of information, which is quite different from knowledge, but we have to invite them to face challenges that, you know, the world is facing, and contribute to cooperate to collectively face those challenges. Because no individual or even no single society, certainly not single university, can face those challenges. So we have to go from, you know, a mode of exploitation of each other and the resources and even ourselves, to a mode where we learn to care for oneself, care for others, care for the planet. And instead of, you know, competing all the time, we have to start cooperating much more. And I think, you know, this is true within universities, this is true between universities, this is true between societies. I mean, we won't solve the climate challenge by competing with one another. We have to find ways that we can cooperate on much larger scale. And that's a huge question on whether we'll manage to do that efficiently or not. But I think we have to change the culture. And to some extent, the universities have a long history. They've co-evolved with, for instance, societies and the elite and the Enlightenment. But they've not all played a positive role during the Enlightenment. For instance, the Scottish universities were, you know, playing a very interesting role during the Scottish Enlightenment. The French universities during the Enlightenment had the right of censorship, okay, which was, you know, the right to suppress innovations and debate rather than promote it. You know, of course, it changed a little since, but, you know, they were closed during the French Revolution for the fact that they had played a negative role until then. So I think universities are very much like, you know, Confucius said, we have two lives. You know, the second life starts when you know you have only one life. And I think universities and our societies know that they have only one life because we are all mortal. You know, this pandemic crisis, many of us we understood that even democracy is entering its second stage. Certainly the American democracy, but, you know, the French democracy is not much better, and many European countries are also under threat, okay? So all societies that we take for granted, like our universities, are, you know, I think to evolve. That's the only way you can adapt to a changing world. So I think our universities have an incentive to change collaboratively in this new network. And they can do this with society, they can do this with their students, they can do this with their staff, they can do this for the better good. And I think that's a very important moment that we are living. Okay. And I think universities should invest in reinventing what universities are for in the 21st century, in the age of AI, in the age of those challenges that are both, you know, personal, collective, and societal, and even global challenges. And you know, what is the Enlightenment? The Enlightenment was a moment when we invented many things, including we reinvented the university from the Middle Age to the modern time. But we invented debate, democracy, philosophy, and so many things simultaneously. But we forgot many people. You know, women were not part of, you know, the human was a man declaration, not a human rights declaration in France. Okay. Citizenship was had to be fought for by all sorts of people, including women, but also the poor people. And today, the younger ones, they are still not citizens. So the very notion of citizenship has to be reinvented. What is global citizenship? None of us is a global citizen the way we are a European citizen or a national citizen, or you know, a citizen of Athens, even for that matter. So how do we reinvent that world package? And if it's not the university playing a role in that reinvention, then who should it be? You know, should it be governments that have all sorts of political problems? Should it be companies that have, you know, all sorts of other issues? I think universities can be a sort of a laboratory for the society of tomorrow. But it means that they have to reinvent themselves, and they have to play an active role, and they have to invent a new way to co-design this with their students, with society, with, you know, the powerful knowledge that different academic disciplines have gathered around the ages, but can keep renewing. And so I think this would be a very interesting role for universities. It's not just, you know, to be a little better in Shanghai ranking. Okay, this is nonsense. Okay, if we are just a little better in Shanghai ranking and the world will collapse, you know, what's good for? Was it good for? But if we manage to contribute to reinvent our societies and the way we interact, we learn with one another, we produce knowledge together, I think then universities can play a very interesting role.
Well, thank you. I like this analogy. It's like in the early 17th century, the natural sciences were not invented in Cambridge and Oxford, but outside at the Gresham College. And maybe the universities have the choice now to also be part of a positive change, of a new approach to solving problems and not to the old scholastic ways. Well, I want to thank all my guests for being with us. Also Maria, who's already back to her PhD workshop. Thank you all for watching today. We will come back in a month with a topic about periphery and center in Europe. And well, thank you all for being here. And you can have the recording of this stream online later. Thank you for being here and have a nice day. Goodbye.